Tonight we welcome Stephen Witt, author of the book How Music Got Free, The End of an Industry, The Turn of the Century, and The Patient Zero of Piracy. Witt is a Midwesterner with a degree in mathematics who played the stock market for 6 years after college, left to work in economic development in East Africa before returning to the States to pursue a graduate degree in journalism for Columbia University. So he knows kind of how the piracy game works from all those different gigs. He is joined in conversation tonight with local singer-songwriter, writer, and editor at The Stranger, Sean Nelson, who you may know better as the lead singer of the seminal indie rock band Harvey Danger, co-writer and supporting actor of the Lynn Shilton film My Effortless Brilliance, and author of a really phenomenal 33 and a third book on Joni Mitchell's album Court and Spark. They will be talking together, a musician and a journalist who's writing about why musicians are all out of work, on our stage, discussing music piracy, the rise of the MP3, and this unusual moment in music history. So please join me in offering a warm welcome for Stephen Witt and Sean Nelson.
Well, thanks. How did music get free? Just kidding. I would like to say that music piracy is certainly something that I have had a lot of complex thoughts and feelings about, as I imagine everyone else in the room has too. Does anybody here not have a complex feeling about music piracy? Are you absolutely certain, one way or another, that it's either righteous or totally wrong? Just raise your hand if you... No? Okay, complex. Good. Well, in the meantime... obviously, music piracy is part of why I'm here in person and not Skyping from a yacht, but not really. The book is really fantastic, and I think that rather than sort of dealing with, you know, the pretense of me sort of asking two specific questions, getting you to introduce it, why don't you maybe give your spiel about kind of what the book basically is.
Sure. Before I start, let me just thank Town Hall for having me, and thank all of you for turning out. This is a much larger crowd than I was expecting, so welcome. So I'm Stephen Witt, and I was a serial music pirate. When I showed up to college in 1997, I had this beige box computer, weighed about 20 pounds, and had a 2 gigabyte hard drive. That makes it about 1/16 the size of your current cell phone. By the end of the first semester, I'd filled that thing with hundreds of pirated songs that I'd got via MP3 chat trading channels. And I didn't, you know, I barely knew what the internet was when I showed up to college. By the end, I was an expert. From there, it progressed to Napster and LimeWire. And by about 2007 or 2008, I had 100,000 pirated MP3s. It would have taken you about a year and a half to listen to my entire library. And I kind of asked myself, you know, where did all this music come from? How did it get on my hard drive? And the impetus, that question was the impetus for writing this book. I ended up finding the most fascinating thing, which was that almost all of the music on my hard drive could be traced back to just one of three people. The first was a German audio engineer named Karl-Heinz Brandenburg. This is the guy who invented the MP3. He's German, he's about as much fun as you might imagine a German audio engineer is to talk to, which is to say not very, but he's brilliant. He's a brilliant guy. Mathematically, he was really a genius. This goes back almost to the 80s that they were working on something like the MP3, but his basic insight is that by taking advantage of sort of these inherited anatomical imperfections in the human auditory system, he could delete 90% or more of the information on a compact disc with only minimal losses in audio quality. It was a brilliant invention, really a hallmark of even the contemporary era. I think his genius is still recognized by anybody who does this stuff. But he utterly failed to monetize it. He was locked out of the marketplace. And so in 1995, in desperation, he posted that encoder online for free. From there, you know, these sort of organized piracy groups started to get a hold of it, and so much so that by 2 years later, when I showed up at college, these, you know, the servers there were just awash with infringing material. But it all goes back to the research that he had done. Eventually, he was able to make hundreds of millions of dollars. He licensed his MP3 players to large corporations like Apple and Microsoft. And at one point in the 2000s, he was actually getting a cut for every computer that got sold with Microsoft Windows installed on it. So a lot of money, as I said, hundreds of millions. And the irony, of course, is that's only possible through the greatest wave of copyright infringement that the world had ever seen. The second guy who's really responsible for this is Doug Morris. And he's the guy who signed all the artists, all the labels, everybody. He built like a gigantic music conglomerate, which, if I understand correctly, even included your music at some time.
Yes.
As well as, you know, sort of seminal hip-hop acts like Tupac Shakur, Dr. Dre, all the other guys that we sort of know and love from the mid and early 90s. It's kind of hard to remember now in this age where nothing is really shocking, but this was extremely controversial in the 90s. There was these culture wars going on, enlisting people like Tipper Gore and Bob Dole, who would just rail against the large media corporations, saying, how can you put out this filth that sort of encourages the murder of policemen and the misogyny towards women? So it got him fired, if you can believe that. He actually lost his job for putting out such controversial music, and Time Warner dropped the entire Interscope label. This is Jimmy Iovine's pioneering rap label with Dr. Dre, which was recently sold to the largest corporation on earth for $3 billion. But at the time, no one could touch it. So he kind of dusted himself off. He sort of brought all the rappers back on to his new label, Universal. And by 2000, he cornered the market on rap, which was the future. At that time, he signed the largest recording label contract in history. He was the most powerful music executive of all time. But then over the next 10 years, he got to watch his empire crumble. You know, he too was fabulously wealthy, but he watched it all burn. And that was because of a third guy, the most interesting guy of all. His name was Del Glover, and he worked for Universal too, at the compact disc manufacturing facility in Kings Mountain, North Carolina. He worked the packaging line. He made about $10 an hour. And every act that Morris signed would appear literally at his fingertips weeks and sometimes months ahead of its official release date. Glover devised a method for getting this music out of the plant. He actually had several methods, but they smuggled the music out. He took it home, burned it to MP3, and uploaded it to a worldwide conspiracy of music leakers that had infiltrated the music industry supply chain all over the globe. Over the course of 7 years, he leaked about 2,000 albums, including almost all of the major hits of the period. You know, stuff like Eminem, 50 Cent, Kanye West's first album, Taylor Swift, Justin Bieber, anybody who Doug Morris could sign, Del Glover leaked. From there, once they made it to this sort of music leaking cabal, it was very quickly available on peer-to-peer networks like Kazaa and LimeWire. Made it into the torrent world as well. And probably within 24 hours of him getting his hands on it, you could find it on iPods and computers around the globe. If you've ever pirated music or just have some music on your hard drive and you don't know where it came from, it's more likely than not that Del brought it to you. He was the patient zero of music piracy. The guy where it all started from. And interestingly, when I first found him, no journalist had ever talked to him before. I was the first guy to find him. He sort of formed the central character of the narrative of this book, and he's just one of the most fascinating people I've ever met, and remains so. Wait till you hear what he's doing next. So that's the story of how music got free. It was a lot of fun to sort of write this book, but it's also kind of the story of how our entire generation became online. For many of us, this experience with music was what really pulled us into the internet at first, especially if you're sort of right about my age, 35 or 36. You can remember how important this was as a teenager. And I think in some ways writing this book, you know, brought that whole generational story to light. So that's the spiel.
It's a pretty good spiel. the structure, it really is there's a fourth character who wasn't included in, I mean, you were alluded to.
Yes.
But that's the guy who was Glover's kind of connection into the world of the pirate organization.
Sure.
Who was, you know, Kali was his screen name, and then you get to a point where you sort of you investigate and you try and find his real life, which is, I yearn to spoil it, but I think I will save it. It's just to, you know, because we're not here to sell BitTorrents of ebooks. We're here to sell physical books. But that part of the story is kind of the most intriguing. Where what's so cool about this story, we think about piracy in these very general terms, like it is a phenomenon that's going on. We know that record labels kind of have prosecuted kids, but it all is broad strokes. And you get right into the specifics, literally who leaked what to whom. But then the question of this cabal of pirates, why they were doing it, it wasn't really just mischief, but it was partly mischief. Do you have a sense of what that motivation was really about?
So just to fill you guys in, without spoiling the book, Glover's music leaking conspiracy was called Rabid Neurosis, and it was led by a guy named Kali, K-A-L-I, the Hindu god of death, or as I call him in this book, the Hindu god of leaking. Basically,
which if it persists can lead to death.
That's right. Yeah. call your physician if it lasts longer than 48 hours. What Rabid Neurosis was an outgrowth of a much older internet subculture called the Wares scene, or more simply, just the scene. And this really was a very tightly knit underground subculture, consisting probably of no more than 1,000 or 2,000 people at any given time. And what these guys did is they essentially campaigned to infiltrate not just music, but the entire media supply chain. So they had guys cracking video games. They had guys inside movie theaters with camcorders. You know, they had guys pirating TV shows and books and even fonts. You know, anything that could be copyrighted, they were attempting basically to strip the copyright off of it and distribute it for free. This goes back to the 80s. When they got their hands on the MP3 encoder in 1995, it just tore the world open. And one of the earliest groups to do this was this Rabid Neurosis conspiracy, which was led by this guy, Kali. Before that, it was led by another guy whose screen name was Al Capone, and he really made the group what it was. I published an excerpt of this book in The New Yorker. I was never able to find Al Capone, and then he finally contacted me. He was 15 years old at the time that he was leading this global music leaking experience. He was working off a 28.8 kilobyte modem in Central Florida, in his parents' house. And I asked, you know, why did you do it? And he said, you know, the dopamine rush. It was just a thrill. And I get it. He was a teenage boy. You know, when I was a teenage boy, we used to go down to the abandoned grain factory, you know, near my house and throw broken bottles around. Like, why? Why did we do that? I don't know. It was fun. And so that same mentality is kind of why a lot of these people started doing this. They were also obsessed with music, and they loved music. They didn't hate musicians, but I think they hated labels and they hated corporations in a kind of a really, you know, punk way. There's a very famous Dead Kennedys tape that came out. This was sort of during the tape trading era. And the first side of the tape was a Dead Kennedys EP. The second side was blank. And the back of it said, you know, home taping is killing record industry profits. We left this side blank so you can help. And I think that was the mentality of a lot of these guys in the early days.
Yeah, it's funny how the rhetoric evolved from, you know, like the home recording is killing music was an ad campaign brought about by the music industry. Right. And I'm sure it did nibble into the massive profits that were being generated by the compact disc innovation. But the idea that it was in any way threatened was pretty overstated. And I think I always had the sense that the piracy kind of arose in response to an existing kind of, you know, stranglehold, if not indeed monopoly, on the, you know, the not just the means of distribution of records, but the way a kid could have access to music was that basically by the late 90s, they had to, if they heard a song they liked on the radio, they had to go and spend $20 on a CD. Right. And the idea that maybe that was inequitable and unfair, I think, did gain a lot of currency in the culture.
People were really angry about that. And the record companies were later found complicit in not just, you know, price gouging, but actually collusion. They were cooperating with music retailers like Musicland to sort of keep the price up illegally. And the FTC fined them for this. Over the 5 years of that they were doing this, it extracted about $500 million from the music purchasing public, which equates to about $2 from every American. So it was a lot, and they shouldn't have been doing that. Now, I think the flip side of that argument is, yeah, there was a lot of ill will against price gouging, but what was really happening was that they were just refusing to enter the 21st century for a long time. They were complacent, and it was the salad days of the compact disc, and they just did not want to give that up. I talk a bit in the book about Karlheinz Brandenburg, the inventor of the MP3. He actually went to meet with these guys in 97 and said, look, here's this technology, you got to get ahead of it, and they just rebuffed him. They sort of said, well, we're not interested in digital music distribution. Of course, they'd actually been engaged in digital music distribution since 1982 when the compact disc had premiered. They just didn't see it that way. You know, those racks of compact discs at the mall, to the retailers and to the musicians and to the label executives, they looked like inventory. But to a computer engineer, they were just an array of inefficiently stored data. And their failure to make that mental leap is really what cost them for years.
There's a... I don't know... exactly how true this perception is or this legend is, but several people I have known in the music business have this theory about compact discs, or at least about the what was going on at the time the compact disc was invented, which is that the record industry was in a slump, not as severe as the one it entered after piracy became a big deal, but that it was on the serious decline. To the extent that the idea that the record business was something that should serve a truly mass audience had kind of petered out. Like the rock and roll era had its day. MTV was happening, but it was on the decline. And then somebody invented the compact disc, and suddenly it was like, we don't have to get new jobs. We just have to sell the same records to the same people for twice as much money at a 10 times the profit margin. And so this like colossal arrogance that you see coming in with the Doug Morris era, and in Doug Morris himself, who's a fascinating character to emerge in the story, but that like the intense arrogance that comes of unimagined success seems like it's a big part of this whole narrative.
Well, the period you're referring to was the sort of tape trading days of the audio cassette tape. The introduction of the dual head audio cassette tape deck made it very easy to sort of make multiple copies of your tape and sell them on your own if you were sort of unscrupulous, or just give them away. In 1982, the industry was in a severe slump. A few things happened that year. That's the year the compact disc debuted. It's also the year Thriller came out, or, you know, right around there. And that's what really, in some people's mind, they couldn't distinguish what had actually saved the industry. Was it the compact disc, or were they just off trend? You know, had they sort of been putting out music that nobody wanted to listen to, and then suddenly Prince and Madonna and Michael Jackson came along? The answer is probably a bit of both. But, you know, I had Thriller on cassette. I paid for it. I mean, I was six. My aunt paid for it, but you know, I loved it.
It was paid for.
It was paid for, and I listened to it so much I broke the tape. You know, so there's sort of two schools of thought. You know, were they failing to put out the hits, or were they suffering from piracy? Maybe you could make the same case later on. Having said that, it's undeniable that digital piracy was a completely different animal altogether. You know, your cassette tape, by the time you've made a third or fourth copy, dub is basically worthless. Like, it just sounds bad. It's not a substitute for the original good. But an MP3 can be copied literally millions of times with no loss in audio fidelity, and distributed for nothing, and it takes up no space. So that creates tremendous challenges for the industry. If you look at markets where there's absolutely no enforcement of copyright law, like China or Mexico, and it's all just CD bootleggers, there is no music industry. It can't exist without at least some kind of teeth behind copyright.
The question of fidelity and quality is an interesting one, and you seem to, in the book, endorse the Brandenburg notion that the MP3 is not just viable, but in fact as good as the supposedly purer, better forms like the CD or the source tape. Not to say that you come right out and say that, but the notion that this information that is effectively inaudible, at least in any way that can be scientifically proved, is a super interesting area, because it really is like there are people who absolutely swear that you're completely wrong. That of course the MP3 is vastly inferior, and that, you know, and in fact the Neil Young school is that like you're robbing people of. He actually does equate it to like there's just more music in the not MP3 version.
Neil Young has spent his career standing next to a blasting amplifier wailing on feedback, so I'm not sure his hearing is actually as good as he thinks it is.
That's a good point. But, you know,
that rocked.
But yeah, I mean, I'm glad he did for all of us. But yeah, the interesting kind of thing there is that what the MP3 kind of revolution did prove is that whether it's shitty or not, like it's the 10-year-old who can't afford $20 to hear Eminem, to buy Eminem's whole record, doesn't care. And the music business was founded on the idea that these like little 7-inch discs were basically disposable things. And it was only as it went along that the idea that these were like heirlooms and collectibles, that kind of gained a certain amount of credibility.
There will always be a portion of the music listening audience who's obsessed with audio fidelity. But time has shown that the size of that, of the total market, will be about 1-2%. You know, in any town, there's like a store that sells really expensive high-end stereo equipment. Very few people shop there. Most people go to Best Buy. And it's true with streaming music as well. Sure, I can pay for Tidal's FLAC. I think they got 17,000 subscribers. Spotify, which compresses to 96 kilobits per second, which is, you know, I think 90. More than 91% of the information is deleted, has 20 million subscribers. So regardless of whether or not you can perceive these differences, the marketplace has shown quite clearly that they don't care. And think about it this way. Compression makes it mobile. So would you rather have perfect audio fidelity or the ability to run around in the park and listen to the music without going over the data cap on your phone? Most people are going to choose the latter.
Which does get into a whole area that I want to get to, but I guess the notion of that being like whether it is scientifically possible to quantify the what you lose when you lose all that information, there's also that notion of like, well, I mean, it's a sentimental one really, but it's like the apple pie that you buy at the store has the same ingredients as the one that is made at home, but the one at home has a certain amount of love baked into it, you know? So there is something like that in the counter argument.
I agree. And look, for people who care about fidelity, I mean, this is the best time to be alive, certainly, if that's what you care about. You'll never have better options than you have before. But the history of recording technology and playback technology shows that people favor cheap, mobile, and relatively disposable options. Going back to the AM transistor radio, I mean, the MP3 certainly sounds better than that thing did. And they sold, you know, hundreds of millions of those. It was really the first mobile wave of music. Vinyl is terrific, but no one is going to opt for a vinyl-only solution in 2015. Even the biggest vinyl head is going to want to have to, you know, is going to want to be able to listen to music in their car or in the park. I think we're sort of entering a two-tiered market where there's a certain much smaller percentage of people who sort of are audiophiles, and they love, you know, the sort of details that are in the music that they can pick up on with these expensive solutions. But it's just not what the average person wants. And whether or not you can tell the difference between an MP3 and a CD also relies critically on your own ability to hear. If you're a musician, you've spent a lot of time in the studio, you'll have a much better ability to do this. The people who show the best consistent ability to tell the difference are studio engineers. And they did an experiment with studio engineers, I think, with more than 10 years of professional listening experience. And those guys could tell the difference between a compact disc and an MP3 at any level of quality, which is pretty extraordinary. I don't have that ability. I can barely tell even at low levels of quality. Maybe I don't have the right equipment, but you know, I'm not going to spend $5,000 to go find out.
No, you should save that money and buy some records.
Maybe I will.
I really could talk about that phenomenon all night, because no shortage of my audiophile friends really are like, if you say you can't tell the difference between a FLAC file and an MP3 file, you have no business calling yourself a human being. And I think that's exaggeration.
Jim O'Rourke, who is probably, in my opinion, my favorite record producer and a terrific musician in his own right, is I think the most honest and authentic voice about this. And he refuses to put out his music on MP3. So what does he gain? Well, his, you know, his listeners get the maximum fidelity that he sort of demands. What does he lose? Nobody under the age of 25 knows who this guy is. So, and I love him. So it's a trade-off.
Also, if you buy the record, you can see the cover painting of the large man being filleted by a stuffed rabbit.
That's his best album.
That's a value add, as they say in the business. But so let's talk a little bit about Del Glover, because he is, he is by far the most fascinating guy in the book, because he, I mean, in so many ways, this is a story about class and, you know, how the economy affects these three very different, well, four very different strata of society. Mm-hmm. Because there's the elite intellectual inventor class in Germany. Then there's Doug Morris, who is the ruthless entrepreneur executive class. And then you have the guy who is at the factory literally assembling these jewel boxes and stuffing the records inside. And he winds up through, you know, like an interest in, I mean, the things he would bootleg and sell before he got into the fully blown into the pirate, he would sell these bootleg things for like $5. Right. You know, it was a very grassroots kind of economy, you know, almost not an economy at all. But he also was like, the struggle of his life to just get by on $10 an hour, while the people above him who were, you know, benefiting directly from his labor, are, the disparity is so vast that you can't help but be really sympathetic to him if you read it in a certain way.
Sure. Although he also, and like the other two guys in the book, ends up being a ruthless entrepreneur on his own.
well, capitalism tends toward that.
The conspiracy that he was in, called Rabid Neurosis, they sort of had this ethos that the leaks were not to be sold. This was not supposed to be a for-profit endeavor. And Glover did not obey that ethos. He really violated it. So you can imagine this is sort of operating as a quid pro quo basis on these secret servers that are encrypted around the world. And as he's uploading leaked music, you know, someone else is uploading, say, like a leaked DVD Oscar screener or a cracked video game or all sorts of other valuable material. And because it's on these servers, you know, 2 or 3 days before it's available on the rest of the public internet, that actually makes them very valuable because of the way new releases work. What Dell ended up doing was building these DVD duplicating towers that could make hundreds of discs at a time, then downloading this ripped material from these secret top sites and selling them out of the trunk of his car. In this way, he started to make a much larger income than $5 a pop, and eventually his operation grew so elaborate that he had to deputize a workforce. He went to the local barber shops around the town he lived in, North Carolina, Shelby, and he'd show up with a spindle of ripped bootleg DVDs and drop it off on consignment. Then he'd come back at the end of the week and collect $500 or $600 in cash from the barbers. And the best of his salesmen actually made more money selling bootleg DVDs than they did cutting hair. So he made actually, his motivations, if you ask him, were primarily economic. And it wasn't even cash, which he didn't really save. He immediately reinvested this money into tricking out his car. So he put these kind of like xenon headlights on it and like a hood scoop and, you know, neon lights and a new paint job. And then the sort of finishing touch were the rims of the car. For years, rappers had favored these kind of rims called spinners, which were on independent metal bearings so that when you drove the car and then stopped, the wheel looked like it kept moving. So Glover was looking to change up the game, and he favored a kind of rim called a floater, which was also on an independent bearing but weighted down so that when you drove the car, the rim looked like it was standing still. So I guess my book is about the guy who destroyed the music industry to put rims on his car.
But it is, like, it's... No matter where you come down on the question of piracy, there is this element where he's not like a hapless victim, but he just seems like a guy who's caught in these massive gears, and the gears are so big that he doesn't necessarily have full consciousness of how trapped in them he is. I mean, I'm sure he knew very well what his economic situation was, but he's making $10 an hour while the guy who runs the company is making $15 million a year and is the highest paid guy in the whole business.
Right. The reason the plant was in North Carolina in the first place was, you know, cheap land and cheap unorganized labor. And these guys just didn't have a ton of economic resources at their disposal. There's a certain read on it, and I'm not sure I necessarily agree with this read, that an academic friend pointed out to me, where it's like, yeah, he's the guy who sees the means of production. He sort of went in and recreated the entertainment industry supply chain in his bedroom, and he actually outcompeted them, which is another way to think about it. It's kind of extraordinary.
He definitely had a more competitive price point.
Yeah.
The interaction of all of the characters without who clearly didn't know each other or know of each other is one of the really impressive things about the book. The structure in that way, it really is. It's you really tear through. I mean, I read the book in like a day and a half. I'm not bragging. I'm just relating that factoid. But I do want to talk very briefly, and we'll get to audience questions if you guys have some. Be formulating them now, and you know you don't have to listen to what we're saying. Just think about what you're going to say next. It's a trick I've learned. I'm not doing it tonight, obviously. But
you'll notice how subtly I'm ducking all of his questions.
I want to talk about the moral question of downloading pirated material, because there's really like that. It really ultimately is the question, because everything is available, and it is really up to you whether you choose to seize it or not. And the question of whether doing it actually, you know, when one person downloads a record and either listens to it or doesn't listen to it, but they weren't necessarily going to buy it anyway, does that change the essential value? These questions are super ephemeral, but like, is it wrong to download music that someone paid to make and, you know, is selling? Is it, I mean, it is stealing, but is it wrong?
The moral dimension is very complex. If I steal your CD, I take it out of your bag and leave, I've certainly harmed you. It's wrong. I think we can all agree with that. But what if I just take it out of your bag, make a copy, and put it back? Who's harmed? You're not harmed. I'm better off. The only person who's harmed is some third-party rights holder that's supposed to get paid when I do that. But if that person's not around to enforce their copyright, is it even a crime? And remember, too, that we as a society sort of have decided on sort of limited reproduction rights. So after a certain period of time, we can do this legally. It's only when the artist has chosen to enforce the copyright, or where they have the ability to, that it becomes sort of legally a crime. Morally, I think when I showed up at college and started doing this, I just never thought twice about it. You know, there's data on your computer. Let's put it on my computer. The idea that when I do that, I'm supposed to, you know, take out my checkbook and write a check to Doug Morris at Universal, that would feel morally wrong, right? So it was a very, let's put it this way, the practical concerns led the moral concerns. Practically, it was so easy to do that morally, you never thought twice about it. Now, with time, it practically got a little bit harder as the media industries were able to sort of get law enforcement on their side and come after the user. After a while, you sort of felt like a criminal doing this stuff. But in the earliest days, you didn't at all. It felt totally normal. It felt natural. So the question of morally, is this right or wrong, is something that's determined not so much at the individual level, but on a society-wide basis of whether or not we want to police people's information exchange on the internet. Decisions made in the earliest days of personal computing sort of said, yes, we'll give the user maximum power and maximum freedom to do whatever they want. They can create their own stuff, they can communicate without barriers, and they can exchange information without limits. And this was kind of a terrific period, but it proved corrosive to the profits of rights holders and media concerns and creators. Since about 2007 or 2008, the tide has really turned. The technologists and the rights holders are now conspiring, essentially, against the user. And the user is no longer someone who's supposed to be empowered. They're a customer from whom value is to be extracted. And I think if you look at your smartphone and how much more locked up it is than your PC ever was, you'll see the consequences of those decisions today.
there's a line in the book where Brandenburg, the scientist who invented the MP3, says, I can't remember the exact context, but he says, I'm not sentimental about technology.
Yeah.
And while that is, you know, it's a great line, I also found it really chilling, because there is a sense that kind of frames the whole story of this in terms of sentimentality, and it made me wonder, like, well, how much of this whole conversation is about a human sentimental attachment to the idea of property or ethics or economic systems or really artistry, or, you know, like, if you really get into it at that level, the relativism is just, you know, rampant. But I have been lectured by my friends. I'm not a devout music pirate. I have downloaded music illegally, and I have certainly had a lot of my music downloaded illegally. I always have thought of it, and maybe it's a rationalization, in terms of an author having a book in a library. The idea of objecting to that, of your work being available to people mm-hmm. who can't afford to buy it, or even don't want to buy it, but just want to read it or hear it, is really striking. I will frame this, I will wrangle this into question form only by saying, now that you're in the business of trying to sell your book, mm-hmm. I found the torrent for it on Pirate Bay today, mm-hmm. And I'm wondering if it has, I mean, books are obviously a different animal, and you get into that quite a bit, but, like, do you have any sense of, like, oh, shit, I'm gonna lose some sales based on this?
The torrent request for my ebook was posted about a month ago on an underground file sharing site called what.cd. So I sort of watched this happen. The book in ebook form it comprises about 400 kilobytes of data. That means it could fit on an old 5.25-inch floppy disk. That's how small really an ebook is. When the pirates really want something, they put a bounty on it. So by the time my request had been filled, that bounty went up to 100 gigabytes. So it was, you know, several thousand times the actual size of the file was the reward that you would receive for uploading it. This spurred competition among the pirates to be the first to pirate my book. And the moment it went available for download in New Zealand, which is just across the international date line, meaning they would get it first, is the moment it appeared online. I actually watched this happen, which was a lot of fun. And then I had to make sure that they had the right copy, right? So I pirated it myself. So the experience of pirating your own book was, for me, a tremendous vicarious thrill. My publisher did not share that opinion. So for me, it's so flattering. You know, you have to remember, this is my first book. I actually didn't think anybody would ever be interested in this stuff. I didn't think anybody would read it. And at a certain point, I was really struggling to get it published at all. So I was just thinking, well, maybe I'll license it on Creative Commons or whatever. So for me, getting pirated is like a pure joy. Like, I just love it. But I know that some other people attached to the project, and in particular, Viking Press, does not share this opinion at all.
They're just a third-party rights holder.
Yeah, they're just a third-party rights holder. Yeah, old media. Yeah, dinosaurs.
The one other thing is that I thought it was sort of a delicious irony that Dell still has the discs that he pirated. I mean, if we're talking about CDs being this obsolete form of media, and after all this, he still has the physical things.
Right. So Dell was eventually, without saying too much, they got him in the end. And they sort of arrested him and did a bunch of things, but they didn't take away his compact discs, you know, because...
They're worth nothing.
Because they were worthless even as evidence, which I find to be one of the best ironies at all. All right, let's get some questions, I think.
Yeah. Sort of a two-part question. First part is, isn't the title of your book false? Because in order to get music for free, people have to pay for a cell phone provider, possibly a data plan. If they're using a home computer, whether it be laptop or desktop, they have to pay for that hardware, excuse me, as well as the fee they pay to the ISP every month for the internet access. And considering the amount of money that's spent on all of those services, isn't the expenditure much higher per individual for music access than it was before people were accessing music by MP3. Second part of the question is, considering that, isn't there an easy solution, which is to have Congress pass, I say easy, I mean economically easy, not necessarily politically easy, Congress to pass legislation similar to what they passed in the early 90s. I think it was called the Home Recording Act, where they mandated that the manufacturers of technology that made digitally perfect copies of recordings pay a royalty to the labels and to the artists. Thank you.
Great question. The answer to the first part is absolutely. Collectively, we've all spent more money on iPods than many of us would care to remember. And partly one of the most interesting things is when all of the music became essentially a free commodity for public download, legally or not, it actually spurred tremendous innovation in the mobile computing market very quickly. Apple at the beginning of 2000 was, Microsoft was 33 times larger than Apple by market capitalization. It was like a niche third tier technology player and even the butt of industry jokes. It's hard to remember. Introduction of the iPod, which was essentially like, if we can think of pirated music as illegal drugs, then we can think of the iPod as the vaporizer. You know, it was a device that sort of activated piracy and made it much more valuable as an economic activity. And, you know, they sold something like, you know, hundreds of millions of these things. I don't know the exact number, but some absurd number of iPods. So collectively, actually, probably more sales were generated by piracy globally in terms of total revenue for business than not. The second question is, shouldn't the artists get a cut of this? It's a great question. And in fact, the recording industry argued exactly this in a lawsuit I talk about in the book, which was RIAA versus Diamond Rio, where the recording industry sued the manufacturer of the first MP3 player, arguing that yes, this is a home recording device, should be covered under the act. The judge ruled that it was not. The judge ruled that an MP3 player is just a hard drive, and you can do whatever you want with it, and therefore, the Home Recording Act does not apply. So Congress would have to pass legislation essentially amending that, which I don't think there's a lot of appetite for. Now, interestingly, even though it wasn't legally binding, Doug Morris managed to convince Microsoft actually to give him a cut of every Zune that got sold. Now, since the Zune tanked, this amounted to almost no money, but a similar deal with the iPod would have probably saved the industry. They just weren't able to cut it.
The iPod was really the thriller of
That's right, yeah.
Apple Music.
Let's switch, go sides over here.
So I'd assume that Jay-Z did his research before launching Tidal and realized that there was this 1-2% niche market. Mm-hmm. I'd also, Rhapsody mm-hmm. is tanking. Spotify's in the red. Why are these groups consistently running towards the streaming model like Apple when it hasn't been proven to be working?
YouTube's never made money either. Even today, it still just breaks even. The answer is that even though they're losing money, people are using it, and especially young people. A paid subscription to Spotify costs about $120 a year. Half of the people right now who are paying for that are under the age of 27. And this was supposed to be the generation that never paid for anything. So I think what the corporations are seeing is, wow, there's a demographic shift that's happening here. People are moving away from torrenting. Torrent traffic is shrinking every year, and people are moving into these paid services like piracy and Netflix, and we got to be ahead of it. So they're willing to lose money for years with the goal of some sort of ultimate end state. Right before Apple Music was announced, they sort of said that their ultimate target was 100 million users. If they can get all those people to pay $120 a year, that ends up being $12 billion each year. About 70% of that will be paid to musicians and rights holders. So that ends up being $9 billion. That's a lot of money. And if they can get it, it's a real market, and they should be able to make a lot too. For now, though, they are going to run a loss for a long time, just hoping to get the long-term market for streaming music sewn up. Between them, so Apple... I should also say Google is doing something very similar, which will launch in September, called YouTube's Music Key. It's in beta testing now. Between them, those two companies have $100 billion in cash to burn, and they control 96% of the smartphone OS market. So they can wrap it up probably pretty well if they have to.
Also, the addition of a new middleman is very favorable to the labels because they find a way to, you know, that 90 or what was it, 70% of the money that supposedly goes to rights holders and musicians. Well, it has to go to the rights holders first.
Yeah, the rights holders cut the musicians a check. But I think Warner, if I'm not mistaken, recently moved to a 50-50 revenue model for streaming. I don't know how that's turned out, though. You would know better than I do.
Well, I bought these shoes secondhand. I got a pretty good deal on them. So it's going pretty good for me. I'm still signed to Warner Brothers, actually.
Are you really?
Technically. Okay. Never met anybody there. Another question?
Do you have thoughts on Apple Music, politics behind it, effect it might have on the industry as a competitor to Spotify?
What do you mean by politics?
I'm sure there's some deals and things behind the scenes. I have no idea what they might be, but I'm sure Apple's been talking to executives and figuring out the business model and whatnot.
Right, so the rumor here, the best political rumor is that they're both Jay-Z and Apple are fighting over Kanye to get an exclusive release of his new album. I don't know if it's true or not. Kanye's an equity stakeholder in Tidal, but Tidal is almost certainly going to tank. So I think he's sort of starting to look outside of his immediate circle of friends for business deals. Apple has, if you believe their own internal accounting, 800 million registered iTunes accounts. On average, those accounts generate about $12 in revenue a year. It's not a lot. If they can get 3% of those users to move to a $120 a year streaming subscription, they will surpass Spotify as the largest paid music streaming subscriber. The prize here is really big, and that's why you see these people moving so aggressively into it. Whether or not they can ever make it succeed in an equitable way, both to artists and to their own shareholders, is really an open question, and the competition is fierce. The hardest part is not really a political problem. It's that all of these services are identical. They all charge the exact same amount of money, $10 a month, for access to the exact same library of 30 million songs at the exact same streaming fidelity. So the only differences are essentially cosmetic. But if the only differences are cosmetic, then actually that's a fight that Apple can win.
I would also posit that part of the attraction or the allure of the streaming model for the rights holders is that you know who is listening to what. It's all very, you know, you have all this data available to you that, like with BitTorrent, you need the help of whatever, the NSA or the FBI to find out what people are downloading. But, you know, if someone listens to something on Spotify, you know exactly what they listen to and when, and, you know, their social security number and their email.
And even maybe where, right?
Right.
So are you big in Japan? Are you big in, are you big in Oklahoma? You'll know where to set your tour dates.
Right.
And that's another sort of additional advantage. Doug Morris, who I talk a lot about in this book, I'll get to you in just a sec. This is the Universal Music Label exec. Was sort of this, he intuited that this was the way to go in the 60s. He sort of figured out very early that as an A&R guy, he had almost no ability to predict the future of what was going to be popular. Instead, he essentially what we would call like a Moneyball approach now, where he just emphasized market research. So while the rest of the A&Rs were out at nightclubs scouting bands, he was in the back office sitting next to the record order taker, tracking very carefully what that guy was selling and where. And he used this market intelligence to push new bands to the market. My favorite example of this is kind of infamous. In 1994 or 93, there was this kind of local bar band in South Carolina that was kind of unusually selling a lot of copies in retail stores. Morris every day comes into his office and just looks at the retail sheets. He studies them like tea leaves, and he could see this weird trending band. He sent his A&Rs down there. His A&Rs went to listen to the band. They came back. They're like, they're crap. Don't worry about them. Just an unexceptional average bar band. But the band kept trending. They kept selling stuff throughout South Carolina and started to move into North Carolina. Morris overrode his A&Rs. He's like, I don't care what they sound like. You got to sign these guys. You got to sign them now. The name of that band was Hootie and the Blowfish. And they sold 8 million records in 1995 across the country. And they are a bad band. The A&Rs were right. If you sent me to scout that band, there's no way I'd sign them. But what Morris understood was that the average, you know, listener, the average person in the public knows something that the A&Rs do not. And so does Spotify now.
Quick side note. the guy who invented the Moneyball process, Paul De Podesta. I went to see Billy Joel with him in 1990, so I don't know what that proves either.
I wanted to go back and talk about the distinction of quality. How do you explain, I guess, the vinyl rise in the past 10 years, how it's continued to grow in sales with it being a quality?
Right. Yeah. So this is the answer that I get a lot of angry letters about. But I'm just going to say it because it's what I honestly believe. When the compact disc first appeared, it drove vinyl almost completely off the map. It almost completely obsolesced it. And the reason, at least for a while, that was believed was because of audio fidelity. You know, the compact disc was marketed as a much higher fidelity format than the vinyl record. And it was kind of true, especially at the time. Now, since then, the vinyl heads have kind of moved into a different direction where the vinyl today is a much superior product to what it was when it was sort of its heyday in the 70s. You have this audiophile, like 180 gram auto vinyl that just sounds a lot better than those old records did. But I got to think a large part of it, if not a majority of it, is antiquarian fetishism. People like antiques, and they always have, and you know, that's driving it. It's got to be at least part of it. People don't like it when I say that, but because they don't want to admit it, but I know it's true.
It's the penny farthing of music. also, it could be that, you know, it has less information on it than a CD.
People may also want a respite from the digital world, which has become really overwhelming. I shouldn't criticize it too much. I still have a bunch of physical books on my bookshelf. Why? They're obsolete too.
Classic, you know, antiquarian fetishism.
I know it is. It is. So I'm just as guilty. I mean, however, I'm not trying to argue that, you know.
But it's not guilt though to own
it's
a
not guilt.
Record.
Yeah. I like the high resolution typeface in the books more than the ebook.
I mean, it's also not the final resurgence. It actually is a resurgence from basically nothing. So even though it has, you know, skyrocketed in the last 10 years, like 5,000%. It's 5,000% of the, you know, there were probably 5,000 vinyl records pressed the year they, you know, that the zero happened. But Donald Fagen of Steely Dan once said, there's a word for people who prefer vinyl to CDs. Schizotypal. And I think that's maybe the end, right? We'll let Donald Fagen have the last word, as always.
Actually, I had a question.
Bring it up.
If you don't mind me throwing in one last question, which is, there's a factoid that I heard on this subject that has really stuck with me, which is that some point in the last few years, the worldwide sale of musical instruments, including like musical making software, eclipsed the sale of music. And that's made me wonder, like, if what the anomaly was the late 20th century, right, where this the like convergence of the economy of scale of this technology and the ability to control it, like, allowed for this creation of a kind of cast of professional musicians, and what we're now returning to is the norm of kind of more amateur musicians and a few big stars who make a living off of it.
Wasn't it live music that outpaced the recorded music, or was it instruments as well?
I'm not sure about instrument sales. I believe live music now rivals recorded. The live music market has tripled since the dawn of the piracy era. So, you know, the money is going somewhere. Economists sort of theorize that if you have a fixed entertainment budget, if you're not paying for recorded music, you'll pay for something else. And it seems like people are willing to pay for, you know, live music and maybe musical instruments as well. You know, additionally, I'm not sure if this number is included in there, but, you know, Ableton Live isn't cheap either, and neither is any kind of production or you know.
It's very cheap on Pirate Bay.
It's cheap on Pirate Bay, and people do pirate it, but I think if you start out pirating it, eventually, actually, you buy it. You know, Skrillex, who has probably used Ableton Live to further his career better than any other musician before him until Calvin Harris, you know, started out pirating it, and eventually he bought it. Now he has the money, but, you know, so in addition to the growth in musical instrumentation, there's also, you know, this new kind of like soundscapes of software that just unlock totally radical and different modes of music production.
Great.
This is a non-tech question.
Great.
How did you meet Del? Was it in a bar or something? And was that the beginning of the process?
the beginning of the process for me was earlier. I became interested in the transfer point. I knew that MP3 had started out as academic software. And so my first question was, well, who is the first person to really start using it to rip people off? And that was how I discovered that underworld of the scene that started happening really in 95 or 96. As I learned more about the scene, I just became totally fascinated by this bizarre underground subculture of the internet. And I started to notice that the FBI was constantly going after these guys and busting them. There's an online government database called PACER, which is Public Access to Court Electronic Records. And from there, I probably downloaded the case dockets of 100 pirates or more and read through them, you know, sort of looking for interesting things. And eventually I found Dell's docket, and I was like, geez, forget the other 99. This guy's done more damage than the rest of them combined. This is the guy. This is the patient zero. From the case docket, I sort of knew his age and his general demographic profile and where he lived. So I went on Facebook and I started sort of like trolling for people who fit that profile. I found a guy. You know, his full name is Benny Lydell Glover. So I found a Benny L. Glover. I actually found several Benny L. Glovers who turned out to be his dad and his grandfather. But I got the one who looked about the right age. And I sent him a Facebook message saying, hey, you know, I'm writing about this subject. If you'd like to talk to me, here's my cell phone number, etc. Send me a message back or call me, thinking, well, if it's not the right guy, there's no harm done. And the next day he called me on my cell phone. Since then, I've probably interviewed him 15 times and visited him several times at his home in Shelby, North Carolina.
So the moral of the story is that Facebook is actually more powerful than the entire music business.
Okay, so I do
and
like
the FBI.
I do investigative journalism. I've also looked at literally every post he's ever made on Facebook. I'm not kidding. And I've got every picture as well. So, you know, once you start digging online, it's unbelievable how much information you can really get from someone. It's actually terrifying.
Well, that would be a good next book.
Yeah, exactly.
Stephen Witt
and Sean Nelson, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you guys so much for coming. You've been a great audience.